It has been 1 month since the historic encounter among the leaders of the two Koreas and the U.S. Following the monumental Kim-Trump handshake at the DMZ, President Trump hinted that Pyeongyang-Washington nuclear talks would resume on a working level within a few weeks. But so far, there's no clear sign of an official dialogue. Instead, North Korea is upping military tensions in the region, putting its focus back on missile launches. Today, we go in-depth on where we stand on the path towards denuclearization 1 month after the DMZ meeting. For that, Dr. Ko Myong-hyun, research fellow at Asan Institute for Policy Studies, joins me in the studio. It's always good to have you with us.
Thanks for having me.
So today's missile launch is the second of its kind in less than a week. How do you see this? What is North Korea's motive behind its latest provocations?
Well, I think North Korea's motive is actually very clear. It's out in the open. I think North Koreans are clearly expressing their displeasure at the lack of, I would say, change of attitude on the part of the United States. Ever since the breakdown of the talks at Hanoi in February, North Korea has been demanding the United States to change its diplomatic approach towards Pyongyang. So meaning moving from the unilateral disarmament of North Korea to a step-by-step approach where the United States would have to show a measure of goodwill by lifting the sanctions, economic sanctions that are currently in place against Pyongyang right now. There has been no progress in that regard whatsoever, despite the three-way meeting that took place in the last month in Panmunjom between President Trump, President Moon, and the Chairman Kim Jong-un. So I think North Koreans have waited 2 or 3 weeks to see whether the United States was ready to embark on this different course, a different diplomatic course. Now that they are seeing that that's not the case, they are expressing their displeasure by carrying out small provocations at the moment, relatively speaking. And I think North Koreans are going to escalate from now on. But then they have two choices in this case. One is to escalate qualitatively, meaning essentially they carry out a provocation that's a huge significance in terms of fomenting tension in the peninsula, such as testing a long-range missile, or like a go down the quantitative path by launching several provocations relatively low significance, such as launching a short-range missile, and then thereby maintain a level of tension that they can use as a leverage over the United States in South Korea.
So you think that's the reason behind North Korea's tactic of sticking to short-range ballistic missiles this time?
That's correct.
To not go as far, not go that far
exactly.
of a distance
to
when upping the tensions. Do you think North Korea is also aiming to gain an upper hand ahead of the planned working-level talks between Pyongyang and Washington?
Clearly. I mean, so when they are sending, the North Koreans are sending this kind of message through provocations, they always have in mind a very different, many different objectives at the same time. They are creating tension in order to force the United States to change its approach towards North Korea. But at the same time, probably back up in their mind, they are taking into account the possibility of resuming the working level talks. And then I think North Koreans are going to put on the table this option that if the United States comes with an agenda that that's likable to Pyongyang, then they will stop carrying out this kind of provocations, thereby satisfying President Trump's wish to maintain the status quo in the Korean Peninsula.
Does today's missile launch violate the September 19th inter-Korean military agreement? Seoul's unification minister Kim Yeon-chul today said that although there is room for other interpretations, he does not believe it violates the agreement. Your take?
Well, I think I would agree with Mr. Kim in this regard. I mean, if you look into the text of the September 90th military agreement between South Korea and North Korea, it doesn't say anywhere there's actually a ban on the ballistic missile test. If you look at the overall statement agreement, it's pretty vague about what kind of obligations each side has in order to maintain peace and stability in the Korean Peninsula. But on the other hand, technically speaking, that's not a violation. But then, on the other hand, the spirit of the agreement clearly states that neither side would actually resort to measures that could increase tension in the peninsula. It's right there in Article 4, Article 1 of the agreement that says that the both sides are going to, stop. Try not to engage in provocative action. So in that sense, what North Korea has done. it's technically not a violation of the agreement, but in terms of spirit of the agreement, yes, clearly a transgression.
U.S. President Trump has downplayed last week's missile launches, calling them very standard. Mm-hmm. But many others in the U.S. are voicing concerns over North Korea's continued provocations. How could the ongoing provocations affect the planned working-level nuclear talks between Pyongyang and Washington?
Well, I mean, despite the fact that what North Korea did this morning and then 6 days ago had a military nature, it's clearly geared towards the affecting the possible discussion agenda that might come up during the working level meetings. So this is, in a way, a North Korean way of conducting diplomacy. So I think in that sense, I think a North Korean provocation is going to somehow affect the American calculation to a degree, because everybody knows that the short-range missile test by itself, it's not significant enough to merit a major round of sanctions from the international community. But on the other hand, look at the big picture, look at the overall pattern, what this short-range missile test could mean in the ongoing gap of negotiation position between Pyongyang and Washington, this could be just a prelude to a much bigger provocations. And North Koreans themselves have been hinting at this very prospect. I mean, when between the last test 6 days ago and then the test this morning, North Korea showed on TV a submarine. And that was being built in North Korea, I mean, which is capable of carrying submarine-launched ballistic missile. I think that's the meaty part of this. I mean, I think the message is there. The clear message is that North Korea, if the United States doesn't engage in more serious approach towards negotiations, then the next major provocation is going to be a launch of a SLBM, the submarine-launched ballistic missile, which actually, the completion of the development would actually complete the overall missile capability of North Korea. So in that sense, I think North Koreans are gearing up for that next phase of a provocation, which is much more serious. And I think Washington understands this message very well.
According to a foreign media report, U.S. and North Korean officials met last week at the DMZ, and North Korean officials reportedly showed willingness to resume working-level talks very soon. Mm. How soon do you think the talks will actually resume?
Well, clearly the message to that is happened this morning. I mean, they launched a short-range missile. So in that sense, I think the North Koreans are sending a message to the Washington that the resumption of the working level talks will be conditional upon the United States coming on an agenda item, as I said before, an agenda item that's actually agreeable to Pyongyang right now. So in that sense, I think North Koreans are saying what they are really thinking, which is they are ready to engage in talks as long as the United States is going to put on the table something that North Korea might like.
So the date of the actual resumption of the talks would depend mostly on Washington's stance.
Exactly, yes.
The U.S. has sanctioned a North Korean man based in Vietnam for violating U.N. Security Council resolutions to support the North's missile program. Now, this is obviously a warning against North Korea's provocation. But how big is this sanction?
I mean, this the last round of the sanctions by the Office of Foreign Asset Control at the U.S. Treasury Department is actually pretty minor, I would say. I mean, we're talking about one single individual based in Vietnam. He's not known to be the head of a major North Korean corporation. So in that sense, it's more of a fact that I think it's more of a target of convenience that U.S. government found to be useful at this present juncture to send a warning sign to Pyongyang. And also, I mean, in a way, the United States matching the North Korean provocation cycle, as if North Koreans engage in small provocations, then the U.S. will match it by, sanctioning a minor individual first. But if North Korea ratchet up the provocation, then the U.S. will be happy to match that too.
Do you expect another minor sanction then from the U.S. following today's missile launches?
It's up to the United States, but we have to understand that the U.S. also wants to resume the working level talks with Pyongyang. So in that sense, unless I think Pyongyang sends a negative message through a confidential channel, I think the U.S. will actually wait out until North Korea and the United States engage in talks again.
The ASEAN Regional Forum kicks off on Friday in Bangkok, and U.S. Secretary of State Mike Pompeo, prior to his departure, has once again said that he hopes working-level talks with Pyongyang would resume. And U.S. Special Representative for North Korea Stephen Biegun is also accompanying Pompeo. Does this show Washington's will to sit down for talks with North Korean officials during the ARF?
Well, I think the United States has been very clear that they are always ready and open for talks with North Korea. Just that the agenda items are not really, and I mean, I don't think the United States is ready to change the, you know, the talking points in the potential negotiation with North Korea. So that became the biggest issue, I would say, right now. So I think, I mean, there's no, I mean, in that sense, the fact that Special Representative Biegun is in Bangkok, despite the fact that there's no evidence that there's, you know, that North Korea sent Biegun's counterpart to Bangkok, Ambassador Kim Byung-gil, shows that, you know, the United States is using, maximizing the chance of having talks with North Korea by taking advantage of all the opportunities that's available to them. So in that sense, it shows a good willingness. But on the other hand, I think that what really matters here is the content of the potential dialogue between the two in the countries. So I think, I mean, North Koreans have made it very clear that they are ready to engage in talks as long as United States changes you know, approach towards North Korea.
Now, as far as I know, it's not yet known who will represent North Korea during the ASEAN Regional Forum. Your guesses?
Well, if Special Representative Biegun is there, then the hope is that you know, Biegun's counterpart, North Korean counterpart, Ambassador Kim Myung-gil will be there too. But then we know that Kim is, I mean, his position is really about having engaging working-level talks with the United States to talk about denuclearization. So in that sense, I would say it's unlikely that he's going to be there, but then somebody else, another deputy minister, could be there. But then if that's the case, it means that this time around there will be no meaningful talks being taking place in Bangkok.
Now, Seoul's foreign ministry has confirmed that foreign ministers of Seoul and Tokyo will meet tomorrow for talks. And foreign ministers of Seoul, Washington and Tokyo will also hold a trilateral meeting. Do you expect some meaningful progress in resolving Seoul-Tokyo tensions?
Well, I think the United States has been making, you know, like a right noise, I would say, in the ongoing spat between Tokyo and Seoul. So I think that's going to act as a pressure on Japan. Right now, South Korea and Japan are engaging in this kind of export control issues, but then these are, in a way, like a one-way issue. I mean, it's Japan which actually has acted unilaterally to impose sanctions on South Korea. So in that sense, I think the United States, if it's going to make a right noise to, you know, to somehow force the two sides to come to an agreement, that's going to act as a pressure on Tokyo rather than Seoul, and then I think Seoul is going to welcome that. So in that sense, I think even this, you know, the idea that the scheduling of a three-way meeting alongside the, you know, ASEAN Regional Forum in Bangkok is going to send a message to Tokyo that, you know, Japan should be, you know, preparing to tying up this current campaign of pressuring South Korea through export control. And I think domestically, I think in Japan, I think this you know, tactic of using export control to somehow, you know, reach foreign policy goals is actually working out domestically, at least. I mean, the ruling party of Prime Minister Abe has won the, you know, the election that took place last week, and totally dominating the election in many ways, so has achieved the domestic political goals. But I think it gives enough reason for Japan to back off from the current round of pressure against Seoul.
Getting down to more specifics, what kind of role do you expect the U.S. to play during the ARF meeting? Do you expect a dramatic arbitration from the U.S.?
I don't think so. I think it's clear that the U.S. has been sending this consistent message to both capitals, saying that this is an issue that should be solved bilaterally between Seoul and Tokyo. So that's going to be the basic stance assumed by the United States, even in the ARF meeting. But on the other hand, the United States has most to lose, probably after South Korea, if this conflict between the two major allies continues in this present rate. So I think this gives incentive for the United States to engage in a way that's going to be subtle, meaning that it's not going to, I mean, I don't think the United States is going to take sides, But then I think the U.S. would like to wrap this up as soon as possible, which again is going to act as a factor of pressure against Tokyo to wrap up the current campaign that's targeting the South Korean IT industry.
All right. Thank you, Dr. Goh. Thank you, as always, for your perspectives.
My pleasure.
And that does it for this edition of News in Depth. From all of us here at Arirang, thank you for watching, and I hope to see you right back here same time tomorrow.